So technology behaves cataract surgery. We have had wonderful talks so far regarding how to use the latest technology to promise best vision for our cataract patients. So this is a real patient I have had, I've seen in the last few months. So this was actually a 58-year-old physician who had undergone uneventful phaco with PCIOL. And ever since after surgery, he had been complaining of a foggy vision. The patient has consulted several ophthalmologists, and when he came to me, I reviewed the past records, and I found that the preoperative records show a vision of 6/18 and 12, and an NS3 cataract disc, it was written as 0.4:1, and NCT was 18, and fundus within normal limit. So it was a perfect phaco, lens in the back, everything was perfect, but still he has foggy vision. So he dilated the patient, and we found that his discs were suspicious. It was around 0.6, 0.7 cupping, and there was some doubtful RNFL defect. And we did the OCT and the perimetry for this patient. As you can see in this OCT, in this RNFL deviation map, there is RNFL thinning in both the eyes. He had not gone cataract surgery in one eye, but both the eyes, you can see this RNFL defect, and it is correlating with this RNFL thinning in the circular tomogram. And there is a incomplete superior arcuate scotoma in both eyes. So we had missed glaucoma in this patient, and therefore the patient is unhappy. Now the patient wants to know from you why the glaucoma has not been detected or discussed earlier, why no tests for glaucoma were done, why the girded visual prognosis was not discussed. So for that, he will seek opinion of several ophthalmologists, and somebody will tell it's a nice surgery, but glaucoma has been missed. Somebody will tell something else, and all this will have medical legal implications. So why was glaucoma missed in this patient? So retrospectively, this can happen to anybody if we do not pay proper attention to the disc before cataract surgery. So why we do not pay proper attention? One is, we can assume, well, this patient has cataract, I'm not getting a perfect view, so let me focus on the cataract surgery first, we'll look at the disc later. Secondly, it can be a very busy OPD and there's not enough time for disc evaluation. So when the patient has cataract, posting for cataract surgery, everything will be taken care of afterwards. Then the AGVF was not requested for this patient. Remember, the patient has 6/18 vision. He would have done quite a fair AGVF because the AGVF was not requested because the glaucoma was not suspected. And you might think that the vision is poor. Let us delay AGVF for the time being. For the same reason, OCT was not requested because the glaucoma was not suspected. And you probably thought that the image quality would be poor. So we must employ all the tools of the trade to detect any abnormality. Whatever has been discussed so far, the first thing is that there should be a suspicion in our mind. Only then we can request some investigations. So comprehensive eye examination with a high index of suspicion, that is the basic thing that that is needed. So regarding glaucoma, we should look at the peripheral anterior chamber depth, do a conioscopy if needed, appellation tonometry, careful disc evaluation is the most important thing. Most of the glaucomas you will suspect from the careful disc evaluation. And if needed, you take care of the investigations like autopated perimetry, pachymetry, OCT, RNFL, and in some cases, anterior segment OCT. For example, in this patient, you can see that the peripheral anterior chamber depth is very narrow compared to this, which is a normal anterior chamber depth. So if you do gonioscopy, you will see a picture like this, and on indentation, you will see like this. So do not be fooled by this pigmentation. This is not the posterior trabecular meshwork. This is actually pigmentation anterior to the Scholby line because it's a case of primary angle closure. And this is the picture of the, in the gonioscope, you see after indentation, you can see the angle has now opened up. This is the actual posterior trabecular meshwork. So these are cases of angle closure. And when you have IAC PI with very narrow angles, particularly if the AC is shallow and the cataract is dense and the patient has borderline IOP, my practice is always to do a IAC PI before the phaco. Why? Because it will avoid a pupillary block during dilatation. You never know, the patient can suffer from an acute attack of angle closure glaucoma. Then when you have an increased AC depth, you have easy maneuver during phaco, and there is a less chance of endothelial decompensation. And most importantly, patient realizes that there is a suspicion of glaucoma, something needs to be done about that. So he's mentally prepared that he will require treatment for that afterwards. Also, you can take help of this anterior segment OCT in select cases. It has been seen that in about 1/3 of the cases of primary angle closure disease, even after IAC PI, the angles do not open up. This is because the basic pathology is in the lens. So this new parameter has come up, which is called the lens vault. So if you draw a horizontal line across the two scleral spots, and you take this perpendicular distance from the back of the cornea to this horizontal line. So this distance from the anterior lens surface to this horizontal line is called the lens vault. If this lens vault is more than 1/3 of this total distance, then this is called a high lens vault, and these patients will definitely, their glaucoma will also improve after a cataract surgery. So now we come to the correlation of the various investigations. For example, if the patient has come to you for cataract surgery and you look at the disc, so apparently you may miss glaucoma in this patient because this patient has around 0.6 cupping. This can be a normal also if it's a particularly if it's a large size disc. But if you look carefully, you will see that there is an RNFL defect here. And then if you do the OCT, you will find that there is a correlating change here in the macular OCT also. And the perimetry shows this few changes. So you should not miss glaucoma in such patients and correlate all the findings. So as you know, you look for the 5 R's in the disc evaluation: the scleral ring, the neuroretinal rim, the retinal nerve fiber layer, the region of the peripapillary atrophy, retinal and the optic disc hemorrhages. And in the glaucomas, you know what about the what are the important features of the glaucomatous field defects, like a pattern deviation plot. This is a criteria developed by Anderson and Patella. Pattern deviation plot with more than greater than equal to 3 non-edge points with p-value less than 5%, 1 point with p-value less than 1% clustering the arcuate area, and this is the known criteria. So you look carefully whether the defect in the perimetry is correlated with the glaucomatous field defect. Remember, even if the cataract is moderately dense, the patient can perform fairly well with a automated perimetry. Moreover, you will have some documentation which will avoid some medical legal problem in future. Then coming to the most important thing, OCT. This is because we are discussing about the technology-driven cataract surgery. So like the OCT, macula is helpful. The OCT RNFL is very helpful to detect various cases of glaucoma. And this is a basic anatomy of the OCT. I will not discuss the details, but just the broad features. Like in case of a normal healthy RNFL, there will be red and yellow color in the superior and the inferior poles. In an abnormal OCT, there will be thinning here. And in this subtraction map, or you can see that there is a red and yellow color here, which means that RNFL is thin here. And this is correlating with a circular tomogram here. So a normal response to an OCT is just to look at the circular tomogram, but you should look at the OCT as a whole. But always remember that there's a normative database with which the OCT has some comparison. So if it is in the green level, between the 5% to 95%. If it is in the red level, it is the borderline. If it is abnormal, it's the yellow level, it's borderline. So these are the things that you should look for in the OCT, and most importantly, you should correlate. Like an inferior RNFL defect should correlate with a superior field defect. So I would not discuss the details. Like you can have a red disease in case of high myopia. There can be red, but the patient may be normal. And you can also have green disease, but the OCT may appear normal, but you should not miss this disc hemorrhage here and the few points in the perimetry. So preperimetric glaucoma are entities. And lastly, I would discuss a small point about the various other causes which can give rise to field defects, like the neurological field defects. Like this patient presented with this disc pallor, but you found that there is a optic nerve glioma. This patient had a meningioma, and this is a field defect opening the vertical midline, and this was due to a pituitary tumor. So all in all, we should stress on the comprehensive eye examination before advising cataract surgery. There should be liberal use of glaucoma diagnostics whenever feasible, and this will protect us from the embarrassment of medical legal complications, and this can prevent irreversible blindness for the patient. Thank you.